Hello everyone, welcome to St. Matthew's. Happy Sunday. We're so glad to have you join us from wherever you are today and wherever you are in your spiritual journey. You are always welcome here, and we are so glad that you are joining us today to be part of this extended community all over this area, all over this country, who's come together to pray and worship together and create this sacred space. Thank you so much for your presence. Today is an extra special day today because it is our Youth Sunday. And so we have something very special that we do here at St. Matthew's that we don't see in a lot of other churches, which is that we kind of turn some of the big things over to our youth. And so we especially do that in terms of having a homily that is given by typically our seniors. And so this year we have both Jack Strong and Andrew Trias, who I know many of you know, a couple wonderful young men. They're going to be co-giving this homily today. And so please welcome them and appreciate the gifts that they offer. They have some great insights to share, and it's so wonderful to have our young people participate in leading our liturgy and showing that faith that has nurtured them and that gets them through tough times and has become such a bedrock part, a cornerstone of their very lives. So I just want to thank Jack and Andrew for all of their work as well. If you take a look at your bulletin this morning, you will see there are some announcements about a few things that are coming up. We've got that Earth Day, that fun little Earth Day game that's going on. So take a look at that. That should be in your bulletin today. I also want to point out just a couple other things. Take a look at some of that wonderful work that we're doing. We've got some things going down to Crescendo Fronteras, our diocesan ministry at the border today. Thank you for folks who've been participating with that. Notice there's an update about Father Colville's class. It's being moved back a couple weeks and will start now in May. So be sure to take a look at that as well. Other than that, there's a few other things in there that you can take a look at as you have time, but I just want to welcome you again to St. Matthew's. Matthews, tell you how much I appreciate you being here, for being part of this amazing community. Let's just take a moment to center ourselves and prepare ourselves for worship this morning. Thank you. Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
To God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. O God, whose Son Jesus is the good shepherd of your people, grant that when we hear his voice, we may know him who calls us each by name and follow where he leads, who with you in the Holy Spirit lives and reigns one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Acts. The rulers, elders, and scribes assembled in Jerusalem with Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and all who were of the high priestly family. When they had made the prisoners stand in their midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and the elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who is sick, and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you, and to all the people of Israel, that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in for no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved." The word of the Lord.
Please join me in reading Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. He revives my soul and guides me along right pathways for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadows of death, I shall fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup is running over. Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
A reading from 1 John. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother and sister in need and yet refuses to help? Little children, let us love not in word or speech, but in truth and action. And by this we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before him whenever our hearts condemn us. For God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God, and we receive from him whatever we ask, because we obey his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he has commanded us. All who obey his commandments abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit that he has given us. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God speak. Pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty. To be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Thank you. finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be heard, and in the quiet, hear your voice. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty. Be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is it's okay.
This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Good morning, everybody. Happy Youth Sunday. For those of you who haven't realized it yet, I'm not Father Dominic, and neither is my friend Andrew here. Today, the two of us are going to be giving a co-sermon in light of Youth Sunday. My name is Jackson Strong. My family has been part of St. Matthew's since before I was born, and I can happily say this is my first and forever home when it comes to the Episcopal Church.
And good morning. My name is Andrew Trias, and I've been attending St. Matthew's for a little over 2.5 years now. Over these last 2.5 years, my family and I have been fortunate enough to call St. Matthew's home because of the friendly community that welcomed us into the church when we got here. I'm so glad to be speaking up here today with my good friend Jack.
In an attempt to be as awesome as Father Dominic usually is, Andrew and I have decided to share a story before we dive straight into today's reading. Our story begins with a tall, strong, and relentless young man named Ferruccio. Ferruccio was moderately poor and was born in the farmland of Italy in 1916. For a child from early 18th century rural Italy, he was abnormally full of curiosity, a valuable feature that led to an equal amount of problem-solving and troublemaking. However, when World War II launched the world into a chaotic global offensive, Ferruccio was dragged into the firefight, eventually flying fighter planes in the Italian Air Force. The world as he knew it had been changed, and yet, even after the war, Ferruccio still managed to retain his most important asset, his curiosity. So when Ferruccio's father began asking about a tractor for the farm, Ferruccio put it upon himself to make one from scratch. Ferruccio knew nothing about tractors, but within a matter of mere months, he had built his father a fully functioning agricultural machine.
After repeating the tractor construction process again and again, and using his resources more efficiently each time, Ferruccio not only brought great success to his family's farm, but had discovered that he could make a very profitable business out of the skills that he had obtained from his bare hands and a curious mind. Soon enough, in 1948, Ferruccio had started up his very own tractor-producing franchise when he was only 32 years old. Much like the very first tractors he had ever produced single-handedly, Ferruccio was faced with early struggles and challenges, which he met with a resilient attitude and began to develop mental fortitude. Slowly, Ferruccio's name began to make its way across Italy, specifically among the rural backcountry farming settlements where Ferruccio's tractor had brought great success to the thousands of individual farms across the vast Italian landscape. With this newfound wealth, Ferruccio purchased a Fiat Topolino along with several other high-end automobiles of the time.
Eventually, what seemed like a few sports cars became countless, as glimpses of Ferruccio could be seen in Alfa Romeos, Lancias, Mercedes-Benz, Jaguars, Maseratis, and more. However, among all of these fiberglass phenoms, these roaring roadsters, one particular car seemed to occupy Ferruccio's mind more than the others. It was the Ferrari 250 GT. It was the peak item in an automobile enthusiast's collection, and Ferruccio couldn't live without it. So, in 1958, Ferruccio traveled to Maranello, Italy, and purchased his very own Ferrari. He was ecstatic. He threw himself into his seat, and with an eager foot on the clutch, he ignited the engine. What came next was quite unexpected. He hated it. It was just a repurposed track car that drove rough and heavy. All the allure, the excitement faded, and Ferruccio realized even he could do better, right? Ferruccio's curiosity couldn't be suppressed, and after taking a look under the hood, it wasn't long until Ferruccio realized that the engine wasn't much different than his tractors. So, with a few ideas in mind, he embarked on a journey back to Maranello and set up a meeting with none other than Enzo Ferrari himself. He showed Enzo his ideas, and the arrogant and witty Ferrari told Ferruccio, "You are out of your league here. Why don't you go back to your tractors and leave the cars to us?"
Before Ferruccio's booming tractor-producing endeavor, he might have cracked under such harsh and blunt criticism from a person like Enzo Ferrari, who not only was the most prominent figure in the automobile industry, but was a popular name across many Italian households at the time. However, Ferruccio understood that he had already proved himself, but only had more to accomplish. So Ferruccio rushed to his garage and incorporated much of the knowledge he gained in producing tractors into hopefully producing his own fully functional automobile, one which was surely more desirable than Ferrari's rough track car. Sure enough, within a short period of time, Ferruccio had created one of his earliest models, the 350 GT, which he knew had enough speed and power to easily compete with Ferrari's models. Shortly after the 350 GT, Ferruccio created an automobile which was like no other model of the time, which even surprised himself. This car had the highest speed and acceleration that anybody had ever seen. Known as the Miura, this roaring machine was easily capable of leaving any common sports car in the dust, which is why the Miura is considered to be the first supercar. By now, some of you may have figured out the man we are referring to is none other than Ferruccio Lamborghini. Ferruccio revolutionized the automobile and luxury sports car industry, and for this reason, his company, Lamborghini, is a cornerstone of the performance vehicle industry. Speaking of cornerstones, and referring back to the New Testament reading earlier, it is easy to see how the religious leaders' positions affected the way that they carried themselves. Being of a higher socioeconomic status and what we would consider to be of the upper class today, these elders, high priests, and religious leaders who devoted much of their lives to their religious practices often made many mistakes, just like we do today. Additionally, many common people saw the priest as a go-between to help foster their religious devotion and achieve salvation. Many of these powerful rulers knew of Jesus' existence and were threatened by his emergence and the power that he possessed, considering that he was the son of Joseph, a simple carpenter. Back in Jesus' time, many people who worked intense manual labor jobs like blacksmiths, artisans, masons, and carpenters were judged by the ancient rulers and leaders to be intellectually inferior. And being the son of Joseph, a carpenter, Jesus likely would have entered into a similar blue-collar occupation like his father. In fact, this is the very reason that so many powerful rulers feared Jesus' presence and teachings. If Jesus had been born into an already rich and wealthy family, Jesus would have easily been able to make a name for himself, and his rise to power would have been much quicker. In this case, the ancient rulers, elders, and scribes would have been able to gather a lot more information about Jesus, and thus their strategies to minimize his influence would have been a lot more effective. However, since Jesus was from such humble and unknown origins, many powerful political leaders had only heard of his growing power, but had no knowledge of who Jesus was or any family connections he had. These leaders were threatened by the prolific following he had started from only 12 disciples, and infuriated by Jesus' claims of being the son of God despite being born of a simple carpenter. This meant Jesus Christ met obstacles in almost every aspect of his life. While essential to his prophecy, they became a significant hindrance to his journey.
Like Jesus and Ferruccio Lamborghini, we all know a thing or two about obstacles. Take, for example, those of you in the congregation who have jobs. Real ones, I'm not talking to my fellow high schoolers out there. Imagine a brash young kid showing up to your office next Monday morning. They're fresh out of college, sporting socks and sandals, and they walk in without so much as a handshake. They put their feet up on their desk, sip on a cold soda, and proceed to tell you that you're doing your entire job wrong. Trust me, I can already tell by the looks of it. Most of us wouldn't be very fond of this individual. Why? We don't know anything about them. We haven't even caught their name yet. However, because they are younger than us, less experienced, and not accustomed to our social standards, we have a natural and instinctive inclination to disregard them. It's natural, and the same thing applies to what I'm doing right now. I've been alive for less time than many of you have been a part of this congregation. Isn't it ridiculous for me to think that Andrew and I, two 18-year-olds, have any religious advice or theological revelations to share with you? We're just kids. We're not educated religious intellectuals like the amazing Father Dominic. But ladies and gentlemen, that is precisely who Jesus was. He was, like Andrew said, the son of a simple carpenter. Yet all alone, he was destined to revolutionize an entire religion, a sect of strict rabbis and high priests who had devoted their lives to Judaism. Why should they let him challenge their authority? Who is he to call them wrong in their devotion to God? Who would blame them if they disregard the words of some young, confident, and socks and sandals wearing zealot? In hindsight, we can understand that Jesus was the Son of God, an incarnation of our Heavenly Father sent to save us from ourselves. It seems ridiculous that anyone rejected him. However, to understand others' perceptions of Jesus, we must put ourselves in their shoes. Jesus was not regular. He was not cut in the same way that others were. He was not a regular stone placed under the pile, but a cornerstone. By now, you've heard that word more than a few times. Between our epistle excerpt from Acts and Andrew and I purposely referencing the word, the idea of a cornerstone has made multiple cameos in our sermon. Now, what exactly is a cornerstone? Definitively, it's the first stone placed in the formation of a structure. It sets the tone for every new stone to be placed. In life, we are the stone set following Jesus. However, at this particular time, Jesus was set as a cornerstone going against the pattern that had been set for thousands of years. Jesus was undoing thousands of years of religious tradition. It was easy to see him as a different stone, one unfit for the pile, but it was almost impossible to recognize his difference as his purpose in being the foundation of our modern church. Therefore, when we understand the reasoning behind the elders' resistance, we see why this resistance was in place and even why it was necessary. Consider how different the church would be if the elders didn't doubt the authority of Jesus. How much influence and impact could Jesus have had? How could a transformative event such as the crucifixion even take place?
While none of us are probably qualified to comment on questions of this magnitude, we can consider how these ideas affect us in our own lives. In particular, let's focus in a little bit on how we behave like the elders, high priests, scribes, and rulers of the time period. Much like Jack's analogy of a young, inexperienced kid showing up to a professional office and barking out orders, how many times do we think that we are doing something the right way and the only way that it should be done? How many times do we get comfortable in the routines that we perform on a daily basis because they're easy, and because of this endless cycle of monotony, we don't allow any room for self-improvement in our lives? Let's be honest, how many times do we think we are superior to others in certain situations? I'm guessing we are guilty of the behaviors I've just mentioned more times than we are willing to admit. Naturally, these feelings of resistance and closed-mindedness to new ideas and norms are a part of human nature, as evidenced by the behaviors of the religious rulers thousands of years ago. While it can often be tough to admit that certain thought processes and feelings are natural for us, this shouldn't be a reason to throw our hands up in the air and accept our current actions. We have the power to change, and most importantly, to welcome change, and we all know this. While these efforts might look different for each individual member of the congregation, we are all able to take steps to improve our personal, professional, and religious lives each day. In the spiritual aspect of our lives, we are able to improve our relationships with God by changing up the ways in which we try and become more like Christ. If we aren't altering the ways in which we pray, observe, and take part in church service or read scripture, how will we be able to see what best allows us to become closer with God? At this point, I assume most of you guys are probably fed up with being compared to condescending elders and corrupt religious leaders. So let's talk about how each and every one of us is Jesus in today's lesson. Much like the mental attention needed to overcome resistance in our lives, it takes a large amount of mental strength and vulnerability to put our own ideas and thoughts into action and manufacture our own change in the areas of our lives that we feel passionate about. You see, while we are naturally hardwired to be resistant to change, mankind as a whole has also shown over the course of millions of years that not only do we invite improvement for future generations, but we put our ideas into action, seeking new knowledge of the world, God's magnificent creation. Kind of interesting how we are hardwired in such different ways, right? And we can see the change from Jesus' time in obvious ways, like the shift from jobs like masons, blacksmiths, and carpenters to labor that is predominantly made up of professional jobs under stable and established institutions, conducted under facilities that look vastly different from thousands of years ago. You see, if we never put forth the ideas that we have due to the pure timidity we possess because of the expectations of others, how are we taking advantage of the blessings and opportunities bestowed on us by God? As the great Michael Jordan once said, if you accept the expectations of others, especially negative ones, then you will never change the outcome. And in this way, we are exactly like Jesus. We have the opportunities to make a difference just like Jesus did on his time here on earth. We just need to have the strength to act in order to overcome internal resistance and rely on our faith, just as Jesus relied on his heavenly Father in times of need.
Like Jesus, in these times when we feel like we've hit a brick wall of resistance, we must remember to have faith. We must shape ourselves as cornerstones. We must reimagine the foundation of our lives, our careers, our beliefs, in order to make change and bring forth structures that can stand to surpass our own legacies. You've all heard the religious adage that a mustard seed can move mountains. It's a far-fetched idea. A seed smaller than a fruit fly has the capability to move a monolith heavier and larger than we can mentally quantify. However, when you ignore the elders and high priests in your own life, you can truly realize your potential and start making progress. You don't have to take it from us. We get it. We're just two 18-year-old kids without a clue what we're doing. Take it from our epistle, which teaches us about Jesus Christ, the man who stood before the cross for us, our sole savior and premier example. Just as Luke said, there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved.
Amen.
Thank you so much.
Please join me in reading the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the light for the world to come. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Please join us in the prayers of the people. After each section, please offer your special intentions either silently or aloud. Rejoicing in the mighty acts of God, who has delivered his people from sin and death through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, let us lift our voices and pray. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Let us give thanks to God for the multitude of blessings he showers upon us, for our lives and for those whom we love, for the beauty of this home God has created for us, for our families and our friendships. Let us give thanks to the God of life. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the church, that it may carry forward the redemptive works of God. For our clergy and our bishops, for the many lay people who serve the church and serve the world through the church, for those gathered here in worship and prayer. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the newly baptized, that the joy of Easter may ever grow within them, and that the Spirit may guide them in the lives of active faith. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the nations and the peoples of the world, that the powers that oppress and destroy may decline, and that justice, peace, and prosperity be lifted up. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Let us pray for those who are sick, those who suffer, those who struggle, and those who have died, that the hope born of Easter give them peace, acceptance, and renewal, and that through their struggles they may come into closer communion with the God who redeems and restores. Risen Lord, hear our prayer.
As my conscience fell, a silly little lie. It didn't mean much, but it lingers still in the corners of my mind. Do you call me to walk on the edge of this world? Spread my dreams. But the future's so far, my heart is so frail, I think I'd rather stay inside. But you love me anyway. It's like nothing in life that I've ever known. Yes, you love me anyway. Oh, how you love me. More than my strength to simply be still, to seek but never find all the reasons we change, the reasons I doubt. Why do loved ones have to die? But you love me anyway. It's like nothing in life that I But you love me anyway. I am the sweat from your brow, but you love me anyway. I am the nail in your hand, but you love me.
To be The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is true, right, and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. May God, who has brought us out of bondage to sin into true and lasting freedom in the Redeemer, bring you to your eternal inheritance. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you now and remain with you always.
Amen.
Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood. Regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes, a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Sin, Jesus is calling.